Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to your National World War I Museum right here in Kansas City, Missouri, where it has been since 1926. And a lot of that has to do with the heart and the commemorative spirit of Kansas Cityans and those here in the heartland who wanted to create a memorial for those who lived through and those who died during the World War, as is written on the tower, which is actually larger than the Statue of Liberty. Outside of the podium, Americans, we like to do things pretty big. And we would invite you all to come back and go through our main galleries to take a ride up into the top of that tower and view Kansas City and to explore the very global collection that we have here. As a nation of immigrants and diverse citizens, we tell that story, not only in our galleries, but in our public programs. And whether or not it's that you're joining us here in our auditorium, or whether you're joining us online, we're so pleased that you are joining us this evening for an incredible conversation and part of our continued spirit of commemoration, not just over Memorial Day. And if you weren't able to join us, we would encourage you to go to our website at www.theworldwar.org and enjoy those keynotes and some of those moments. But throughout the year, we commemorate those who serve and who sacrifice, not only in World War I, but throughout. Now tonight, we are proud to welcome Sergeant Major retired Gavin McIlvenna. It's close enough. He's going to correct me here in just a second. I had it right for about 5 minutes and then get a microphone and all these lights. He is the 11th president of the Society of the Honor Guard, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. But as we head into the summer, we hope that you continue to make the museum and memorial a frequent destination. And one of those times that we hope that you are here enjoying a picnic or the sunset is another public program, which is going to be Wednesday, June 6th, Modern Music Historical Inspiration, where we are going to explore the creation of a new choral work called We the Unknown, with the composer, the co-librettists, and a historian by the name of Dr. Jason Krauthammel, who will discuss the creative process behind a new harmonic work and the historically inspired narratives honoring the experiences of African Americans, the queer community, and women during World War I. Now, it's my honor to introduce briefly a gentleman who can speak more to this incredible work, a singer, a board member of the Heartland Men's Chorus, and a veteran, retired Lieutenant Colonel Robert Hill.
Thank you, Laura. In addition to my connection to the Army, I work today as an Army civilian, and my connection to the Heartland Men's Chorus. I'm also an occasional volunteer here at the museum, and it's a great joy to be able to interact with individuals coming to visit this place of history and learning. But the reason I'm up here to speak is that Gavin came to Kansas City through a joint partnership between Heartland Men's Chorus and the museum. As Laura said, we are going to do the world premiere of a new choral work that tells the story of how the unknown soldier of World War I was selected. It's about a 40-minute piece, and it will be performed as a part of our larger concert, Indivisible, Songs of Resistance and Remembrance, at the Folly Theater on June 9th and 10th. And I and another chorus member will be out in the lobby afterwards. If you're interested, we've got some handouts. And if you're eager enough to buy tickets, we'll help you with that as well. So I am now going to turn it back over to Laura to introduce Gavin.
And also, if you are just trying to figure out your calendar, I sometimes have a hard time keeping track of mine, you can go to their website as well, which is hmckc.org, and you can get more tickets there. As I mentioned, we commemorate throughout the year, and what has become an annual tradition here in Kansas City is Taps at the Tower, which will be occurring June 17th through the 23rd. And whether it is for a family member or just to honor those who have passed, we would encourage you to come back for what is a beautiful moment to watch the sunset and hear taps being played and the recitation of a wonderful reading. That's a very brief ceremony, but it has become one of my favorite moments during the summer. And we would encourage you to come back here for that free moment at the Memorial Courtyard as well, and continue that tradition of commemoration and honor. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce Sergeant Major retired Gavin McIlvenna, the 11th President of the Society of the Honor Guard, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Retired from the U.S. Army after nearly 23 years of service, where he held key leadership positions, led peace and contingency operations, and earned several decorations. And as I watched him walk through the halls on an incredibly busy Memorial Day, you can just pick him out of a crowd as a member of the military just for his posture alone. In 1999, Sergeant retired McIlvenna was one of four former tomb guards who created the nonprofit organization, Society of the Honor Guard, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, where he served as the first secretary. After retiring in 2012, he served as a state trooper in Oregon, where he was a medic team leader for the OSP Special Operations, amongst other positions. Currently, he still serves in the Army Reserves and is a life member of the VFW, which we are pleased to be the home of here in KC. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming Sergeant Major retired Gavin McIlvenna.
Well, thank you, Laura, for that introduction. I truly appreciate it. And wherever Camille is, thank you for all the help that you've provided getting me ready for this. And Rob, of course, for introducing me to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. My name is Gavin McIlvenna. I am a retired sergeant major. And during a portion of my time, I had the distinct honor to guard the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier as the commander of the relief for First Relief, as well as assistant sergeant of the guard. It was probably about the midway point of my career. As Laura had mentioned, in 1999, I became one of the first four members to create the Society of the Honor Guard, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. We're all volunteer, made up of current and former tomb guards and like-minded Americans. And as a nonprofit, our primary goals are to come out and educate people about the unknown soldiers that are buried in Arlington National Cemetery, about the process that each of them went through, as well as the sentinels that stand that eternal watch. I was going to introduce some slides about World War I, but after coming through the museum on Memorial Day, I decided I would pull those slides because I'd really like to be invited back. If you haven't been through, this is a beautiful facility. They have great displays, and you can certainly learn an awful lot about the why the war started and why we became involved in it. What I would like to talk to you today is about the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. And I'll kind of take you through the process of each of the unknown soldiers, as well as a little bit about the sentinels. So the picture that you see here is one of my favorite. This is probably one of the earlier photos that we've had. This is in 1929, and this is what the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier originally looked like. Now, keeping in mind that we're talking about the 20s, and most of us back then probably didn't own a car. Getting on a train was probably a challenge, certainly traveling out of our country and going overseas. So you can imagine the families, how they felt when they put their loved one on that train in uniform to go off to a foreign war and then never return? Where do they go to remember them? They don't have a grave. They might have one overseas, but again, we're talking about the early 20s where travel overseas was very difficult. So I can imagine the anguish and the heartache of each of those family members not being able to, on a day like yesterday, Memorial Day, to go and visit them and say whatever they needed to say to them. The Tomb of the Unknown Soldier is that place in America where, regardless of the conflict, regardless of our demographics, you can go and pay your respects to all of the soldiers that have fallen in defense of this nation and all of the soldiers that unfortunately will fall in its continued defense. Let's talk about the tomb for a bit. The Unknown Soldier idea actually started with Great Britain, and France in 1920. After the war, both of those nations wanted to find a way to honor the sacrifice of so many soldiers during the conflict. Now, how many of you have been to Westminster Abbey? A few? Okay. That is where the Unknown Soldier from Great Britain lays. And the interesting thing about Westminster Abbey is that as you walk through there, you may look down at some point and find yourself standing on the grave of the king, but not the Unknown Soldier. That is the one grave that you can't walk across in Westminster Abbey. Anybody know where the French Unknown Soldier happens to be buried? The Arc de Triomphe in France, yes. Same kind of idea. So Gold Star mothers and veterans came to a gentleman by the name of Congressman Hamilton Fish and said, why haven't we done this? We're America. We need to do this kind of a thing. We sent so many of our sons overseas, and so many of them didn't return. We need to find a way to do something very similar. Now, Congressman Fish was actually a captain during World War I. He fought with the famed Harlem Hellfighters, who, if as you go through the museum here, you'll find that their history is very high. The French loved them. They were warriors in battle, and they have quite the reputation of being vicious fighters. He was moved by the sentiment of asking for something similar to be done in the United States, and he absolutely agreed. He felt that that was absolutely the right thing to do. So he introduced a bill into Congress, and he said, we need to do something similar. But we want to find an unknown American soldier who served in the American Expeditionary Forces and bring them home and bury them in our own land. I brought in people like General Pershing to the congressional hearings, and they pled their case to Congress, and Congress agreed. And in March of 1921, President Wilson actually signed into law the congressional order saying that that's what needs to happen, that we will bring home an unidentified American who served in the American Expeditionary Forces and died in battle, and we'll place him in the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. The original idea was to make that happen around May of 1921, Memorial Day. The task for finding an unknown soldier from all of the different graves in France fell to the United States Army's Quartermaster Corps. Now, back in these days, remember, where a soldier fell is most likely where they were buried, just as in the Revolutionary War all the way through this time frame. So those soldiers were in makeshift graves, makeshift cemeteries, and then at some point they were shifted to larger American cemeteries. So you can imagine there's probably not a lot of paperwork trail from where they first were laid to where they were when the selection process happened. We also don't have the great technology of DNA. These guys aren't running around with name tags or dog tags. They don't have the DNA in the system like they do now for the soldiers. So if they had laid in their grave for 6 months to a year, who knows how easily we could have identified them. The mandate to the Quartermaster Corps was to find the soldiers that had passed, make sure that they had died of combat wounds, that they were American, and there's no way to identify them. So they originally decided to go ahead and get 8 different candidates. And through the process, they went to each of the 4 primary cemeteries where Americans were buried in France. Out of that, they came down to a selection of 4. They transported those 4 from each of their individual cemeteries under escort to the town of Chalons-sur-Mar, where the Hotel de Ville is, and that's the seat for the city. It's where the mayor lives. And when they did that, they brought them into one room, and they're all in identical coffins with identical flags on them, and they promptly shifted all of the caskets. All of the documents saying that this soldier came from this cemetery and this one came from this cemetery were collected and destroyed. So there's no possible way to know that the one that's in the right-hand corner of the room came from this cemetery. And a guard was put on him on what we call a death watch. So now we have our unknown soldiers that constantly have a vigil standing over them to make sure that they are safe. Somewhere in the night, when the guard change happened, the coffins were shifted again to ensure that nobody knew anywhere that they came from. Originally, it was going to be an officer that had served during the war that was going to make this final selection. But that officer said, I don't want to do that. I think that the person that needs to do this is somebody that fought hard in the trenches next to him. And he felt that Sergeant Edward F. Younger, who is also buried in Arlington National Cemetery, was the perfect person for this. And truly he was. He fought in every one of the major campaigns. He was wounded by artillery fire. He was wounded by machine gun fire. He fought and he helped bury the dead in each one of the cemeteries where the bodies came from. So he had personal ties to every single one of them. But this is a pretty big task. How would you like to show up Monday morning to work and they say, oh, by the way, this is what you're going to do for the nation? So a little bit of pressure. I want to read a quote to you that Sergeant Younger talked about when he looked at having to do this. He said, I was left alone in the chapel. There were four coffins, all unnamed, all unmarked. I walked around the coffins three times, and then suddenly I stopped. What caused me to stop, I do not know. It was though something had pulled me. I placed the roses on the coffin in front of me, and I can still remember the odd feeling that I had standing there alone with the unknown soldiers. The third casket from the left is the one that he selected to represent all of the missing and dead from World War I. Our unknown soldier had been selected. The other three caskets were returned to the graves, the cemeteries there in France, and were buried under a simple headstone that says, Unknown American Soldier. The body was placed into a brand new casket, brand new flag placed over it, the guard was still there, and then the rooms was opened up so that the French people could come in and pay their respects to this unknown American. And if you think about it, ever since the Revolution, the United States and France have kind of always been there, haven't they? In one way or another, whether we're supporting them or they're supporting us. Well, this is the first time that American soldiers have gone to France and defended their nation and helped liberate them. So they truly felt that power and a bond with that soldier. And it was an outpouring of respect that was shown. The unknown soldier, the very next day, in October of 21, was then given appropriate military ceremonies. He was put on a train and he headed to the port of Le Havre, where he was going to embark on the USS Olympia for his final voyage home. Now the French are very good at ceremonies. They've been doing it for a lot longer than we have, and they did it right this day as well. Just before the unknown soldier was taken aboard the USS Olympia, they presented him with their nation's highest award for valor. It's the least that they felt that they could do for someone who had given up their lives, as well as their identity, to defend their nation. Once the unknown soldier was placed aboard the USS Olympia, again placed under military guard by the United States Marine Corps and the United States Navy, and began that long voyage home from October into early November. Once arriving in November, he went into the Potomac. Now you can imagine back in the day having one of these very large battleships cruise up the Potomac. It must have been quite the sight to see, especially when it's one of the Great White Fleet, so it's painted white. It probably just stood out. Once they arrived at the Navy Yard in Washington, D.C., they stopped at Pier Number 3 and began the process of removing the unknown soldier from the Olympia. For those of you that love music, they played the funeral march as he was carried off the ship. And you know how powerful that music is. And then as soon as the body bearers touched the pier, our national anthem began to play. And our soldier was home. He went from the pier up to the United States Capitol under appropriate ceremonies, and he laid in state. Now, I cannot remember the name of how to pronounce it, but does anybody know what this is called? A bier. There's a more appropriate name for it. I think it's called a catalyph or something similar to that. But this is the exact same platform that President Lincoln laid upon when he laid in state. It's the exact same platform that Garfield and John F. Kennedy and each of the unknowns lay upon. We'll talk about that more when we get into the double internment for World War II and the Korean War unknown soldier. This was the opportunity for Americans to now pay their respects, and thousands upon thousands did, filing in. Think about the veterans that did that, that don't know who's in that casket. Their buddy that didn't come home from war. And World War I was a horrific war, and advances in technology made it incredibly lethal to where identifying bodies was difficult. All those families that couldn't be there, at least they knew that people were paying respects. He lay in state for a couple days, and then on November 11th, he began that final transition. Coming down out of the Capitol, he made the transition onto a caisson horse-drawn carriage and carried into Arlington. And one of the interesting things about the ceremony at this time was that everybody here has got a cell phone, right? You can get on the internet, you can Google something, you can watch something live, right? Back then, none of that was there. How did people get their news? Newspaper, right? Which would always mean that it's after the fact. Or if they were lucky enough and had radio broadcast. Well, the precursor to AT&T and the Bell Corporation did something very revolutionary during this time. They actually placed a phone call, a live phone call, from the time the unknown soldier left the Capitol building till the time he was buried in Arlington National Cemetery. They didn't record it, unfortunately, so we can't hear what it sounded like, but you can imagine that commentator having to describe what he's seeing through the entire process. And it was played in New York City, in San Francisco, and there in Washington, D.C., so millions of Americans got to experience this. And during the ceremonies in Arlington National Cemetery, there was something called the National Salute. And that's something that the Society has been working on to try and get reinstituted every November 11th here across the United States. We've been working on it for about 3 or 4 years, and it's something that you can help us with. It's very simple. On November 11th in 1921, they paused for a minute to remember all of the dead from World War I. Then they continue that pause for another full minute to think about all of the soldiers that in the future are going to die for our nation. And then they ended it by playing taps. Something very simple that you can do in your communities by ringing bells 21 times, pausing to remember all of your community's veterans that didn't make it home, and then playing taps. I encourage you to join us across the nation as we do this year and continuing up to 2021. President Harding gave the eulogy, and I want to read something that he talked about in 1921. He said, "We are met here today to pay the impersonal tribute. The name of him whose body lies before us took flight with his imperishable soul. We know not whence he came, but only that his death marks him with the everlasting glory of an American dying for his country. Hundreds of mothers are wondering today, finding a touch of solace in the possibility that this nation bows in grief over the one that she bore, to live and to die if need be for the Republic." And with that, he conferred upon our unknown soldier the Congressional Medal of Honor, our nation's highest award for valor. There were other nations present there to witness this, and each one of them came forward and did the exact same thing. And this is one of the first times, and I'm going to have to double check, but I'm pretty sure it's the only time, that an American has received the Victorian Cross, the British highest award for valor. At the same time, the Belgian commander representing his nation had a nice little box with his nation's highest award. But instead of using that one, he was so overcome with emotion that he ripped the award off of his own chest and placed it on the casket of our unknown soldier. Because again, Americans helped liberate his nation. He was carried from the Memorial Amphitheater down to where he lays today. And just before being placed into the ground, a gentleman by the name of Chief Plenty Coup, who represented the Crow Nation and all of the Native American nations, placed upon our unknown soldier the war bonnet and his coup sticks. And if you know anything about Native American tradition, you understand that that is a great honor. As he was lowered into the ground, there's something that most people don't understand or don't know about, but underneath where he actually laid inside that crypt is 2 inches of soil from France, the same battlefields that he fought up in. The cap was placed, and the unknown soldier was finally home. What you see in some of the older pictures is this very beautiful, simple headstone, very flat. And if you look at the vista, you see Washington, D.C. there. You see the Lincoln Memorial and the Capitol Building or the White House, right? Well, back then, think about people that were coming into the cemetery to pay their respects. Maybe they don't understand what this was. So unfortunately, in about 1925, a veteran of the war comes around the corner to pay his respects to the unknown soldiers, and what does he find? Somebody having a picnic on that big white marble flat piece. If there's veterans in the room, I know what your response would have been. It would have been the same as mine, probably just as colorful, to let them know that what you're doing is inappropriate. However, this person went down to the White House, knocked on the door, walked in and told the man, "This is wrong, you gotta do something about it." Something that we all, I think, probably wish that we could do today, going down to the White House and talking to the president. The president said, "You're absolutely right, that is wrong. We need to fix it." Now, Congress had originally intended to put something on top of the grave, some sort of sarcophagus. So, immediately, a civilian guard was placed on duty during the hours that the cemetery was open, to make sure that none of this tomfoolery would happen again. And they started the process of designing what is now what you see, the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. One of the interesting things that people may get a misconception of in the media is you hear them refer to the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier as Tomb of the Unknowns, right? There's one tomb, this one, 12 feet down is the unknown soldier from World War I. That is the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. These crypts, which are to the west of the tomb, and there's a third one over here, they're not part of the tomb. They're their own separate graves. Unknown soldiers from different wars are buried in those. So when they say Tomb of the Unknowns, it's not exactly correct. It's Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Okay. The marble itself came from Colorado. It's about a 75-ton block. And you can imagine back in those days that transporting a huge solid block of marble was probably a technical challenge or a logistical challenge. You had to dig it out of the mountain, which took about 75 guys to do, somehow transfer it down the mountain without breaking it, put it on the horse-drawn carriages, which I'm assuming you would probably need a lot of horses, right? Get it down to the train station for probably a very bumpy ride all the way to Washington, D.C., where the same people that carved the Lincoln statue now had one chance to get this right, because the whole process is going to be difficult if they screw it up, right? So on the tomb itself, on the north and south side, you're going to see inverted wreaths. Now these inverted wreaths represent the 6 major battle campaigns of World War I. They're inverted to represent mourning. Most of the time wreaths were going the other direction. The west side of it is what people think today is the front of the tomb, because it's got the words written on it that everybody sees, and that's where people lay wreaths. But the front side is actually on the east side, and it has 3 figures. It's a beautiful carving into the marble, and each of these figures represents peace, valor, and victory. And you can see that their hands are intertwined because peace, valor, and victory are all intertwined when it comes to the sacrifices made by the soldiers during World War I. So it's kind of blocked off to where you can't walk up and get a good view of it, but there are some great pictures out there that give you the detail of it, and it is truly an amazing carving on the tomb. So in 1926, we saw the civilian guards transition to military guard. Again, just during the time that the Arlington National Cemetery was open. And you went from the original tomb itself to the much larger tomb. Chains were a lot closer during those times. And when they finally put the mats in that you see the sentinels walking on today, you could actually walk up and across the mats. You could walk next to the sentinel. You could see whether or not they're doing their duty. And over time, those chains have been pushed back a little bit further and further. So during my time that I was down there, there's no way you could get up that close personal to the sentinels. The war to end all wars, right? World War I, the Great War, we're not going to do it again. It's the war that changed the world, definitely made America a power player on this world stage. Well, unfortunately, we tend to not learn from war, and World War II started. Again, covering the globe, two different theaters, and by the time the war was over, the veterans said, we need to do something very similar. We need to have an unknown soldier placed in Arlington next to the original unknown soldier. And one of the draft plans called for almost an exact duplicate of the tomb as you see it, just kind of side by side now. They said, all right, we're going to do that. Congress agreed and said 1951 is when we're going to make that happen. What happened in 1950? The Korean War. I'm sure there's some of the veterans that are in this war. Thank you for your service during that conflict. War started. Everything gets put on the shelf. They take care of the war. 1953 is done. The AMVETs and veterans say, all right, we're done. We need to do this. And Congress said, you're right, we're going to do it, but we're going to do a double internment. So we're going to inter the World War II unknown soldier as well as the Korean War unknown soldier. The logistical challenges were still there. You had to find candidate soldiers, much like was done during 1921 in both the Pacific and the European theaters. And at some point, we're going to have to find a way to bring them together and make a final selection. So they went through roughly the same process. They went to cemeteries in France and throughout the European theater, selected soldiers that they could not identify except for the fact that they were American and they had died in combat. They made a selection for the transatlantic. They did the same thing in Hawaii for the Trans-Pacific. And within days, they also did the same thing for the Korean War unknown soldier. Now, the Korean War unknown soldier was designated in Hawaii. The Trans-Pacific candidate was also designated in Hawaii. After the appropriate ceremonies, they brought the unknown soldier, or the candidate from the transatlantic, aboard the USS Boston. So they flew them from France to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, placed it on the USS Boston, and started transiting to the Virginia shoreline. The Trans-Pacific and the Korean War unknown soldiers were flown to the United States, landing in Travis Air Force Base, landing in Travis Air Force Base, and then coming across to Virginia, where they were put aboard the USS Blandy. Those ships all met at sea, about 70, 75 miles off of the Virginia Capes. Do we have any Navy veterans in the audience? Then you probably know better than I, transferring something at sea is a logistical nightmare. With high lines and ropes, moving ocean at speed. Well, this wasn't just food or supplies that they're transitioning. They actually did the process of moving the bodies from one ship to another. So they brought all of them aboard the USS Canberra. They immediately separated the Korean War unknown soldier and placed a guard upon him with the United States Marines. And the two candidates were placed into a room. They were transferred into identical caskets. Flags were draped upon them. They were shuffled about. And the guard was posted for over a day. And sometime during there, they would come in and they would shuffle them some more so that there's no possible way to know that this casket came from this ship. i.e. coming from this theater of operation. They brought him out onto the fantail of the USS Canberra, where hospitalman First Class William R. Charette made the final selection for the World War II unknown soldier. He selected the soldier, or the casket, that was to the right of the Korean War unknown soldier. So this is the Korean War unknown soldier, already designated in the center, and these were the two candidates. Having never seen it, only read it in books or seen it in the movies, I'm sure it's very impressive and very moving, but that candidate that was not selected was given a full military burial at sea. Once this was done, both of the unknown soldiers were then transferred back to another ship for transport back up to the Potomac, where they arrived in May 28th and started the process that was just like it happened in 1921, with the World War II soldier coming off the ship first, followed by the Korean War unknown soldier, making the ceremonial transit to the Capitol building where they lay in state. Now, there's only one bier that cast upon, so there was a second one created, and as the soldiers lay in state for 2 days, on that second day, they made the transition so each of the unknown soldiers lay on that specific bier. Again, thousands of Americans paid their respects to our unknown soldiers, filing in and then following the ceremony as they were taken by caisson to Arlington National Cemetery, where again, they were both awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor and laid to rest. And a question that I have for you is, during a military ceremony, when you have that flag across the casket, it gets folded and it gets handed to the next of kin. Who's the next of kin for the unknown soldiers? Who's there to accept that awesome responsibility? In this case, it's the presidents of the United States. So in World War I, it was President Harding. In World War II, President Dwight D. Eisenhower, most fitting because he was the Supreme Allied Commander during the war. Vice President Richard Nixon was the next of kin for the Korean War unknown soldier. And fast forward to 1984, President Reagan was the next of kin for the Vietnam unknown soldier for the 14 years that he was designated. This is what, in 1958, the tomb of the unknown soldier looked like. Again, the tomb where World War I is buried, you have World War II and the Korean War unknown soldier. In 1984, America was dealing with the issues of the Vietnam War. And you have to admit, we didn't treat our soldiers very well. Not like today. When I came home from war, it was vastly different. And there was plenty of political pressure to find and designate an unknown soldier from the Vietnam conflict. If you've ever had the opportunity to listen to Colonel Patricia Blase give her presentation about what her family went through as the government identified her brother as an unknown soldier and laid him in Arlington National Cemetery, I suggest you go on YouTube and listen to her story. Needless to say, in 1984, they knew who the unknown soldier was. But because of politics, they went ahead with the ceremony, following the same traditions that were done in 1921 and 1958, designating that a set of remains as X-ray 26 as that Vietnam unknown soldier, in Hawaii, bringing him home to the United States, going through the same process and burying him in between the Korean and the World War II unknown soldiers on May 30th, 1984. Fast forward to 1998. That's when I was down there. I was a relief commander for First Relief, and it was during that time that they did the disinterment of the Vietnam unknown soldier. So the family had said, we would like to have the unknown soldier disinterred so we could test with DNA to make sure that that's our son in that grave. For me, personally, there's four unknown soldiers. Every time I look at the tomb, there's four unknown soldiers. Because I got the privilege of guarding that unknown soldier as he represented all of the fallen and missing from that conflict. At the same time, I truly understand how the family's closure was necessary. And they were able to take their son and their brother home and bury him in the St. Louis Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery. The process for getting the unknown soldier out of where he was buried was very arduous. The company that put him in, you have a concrete casing, the crypt itself. There's a concrete cover over the top, and that's sealed to prevent damage. And then the marble crypt cover that you see was placed on top. And when the company put them in, they said, "We're doing such a good job, they'll never come out." Well, in 1998, they called the company back and said, "We need you to do this." And it wasn't until about 2 or 3 in the morning that they finally were able to break that concrete seal without damaging anything else and finally get that unknown's casket up and out. And the MDW commanding general at the time was a Major General Robert Foley. And he is a Medal of Honor recipient from Vietnam. He's about 6'6", someone that whenever he came down to the quarters, we'd be looking up to as tomb guards. He turned around, he pointed to a couple of the sentinels and said, "I need you to get in there, I need you to lift the casket out." As tomb guards, our mission is to protect the tomb from any disrespect. Nobody touches the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Nobody touches the crypts. We don't allow that. That's our mission, as dictated by Congress. So for the general to say, "Get in there and touch this casket," was mind-blowing for those two sentinels. And they balked. And the general said, "Look, it's really easy. You're going to do it as tomb guards. I'm going to have the construction workers do it." Soldiers did what they were supposed to do. They got in there, and I can tell you from personal experience having talked to them, it did mess with their mind thinking about, "I've been protecting everybody from touching this, and now here I am handling the casket and lifting the body out." It messed with them. The ceremonies were conducted the next morning, and it was difficult to stand on the side of the plaza and watch as my brother was taken away, someone that I had stood the watch over, someone that I had protected for even the very short period of time that I was there, which is why every time I look at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, I still see 4 unknown soldiers. The casket, or I'm sorry, the crypt cover was re-engraved to talk about how we're honoring and keeping faith with America's missing servicemen. The crypt itself remains empty. There's nothing in there. We still provide the honors and we still do flags in and lay wreaths there as if there is an unknown soldier buried in that crypt. We still believe that. Let's quickly talk about the old guard. Now this is the unit, the 3rd United States Infantry Unit, that has been given the responsibility in 1948 to be the escort to the President of the United States, as well as assume the duties of the caisson platoon, the drill team, and the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. It is the oldest infantry regiment, having served as far back as our Revolutionary War, and it is quite an honor to be a part of this regiment. To join this regiment, you have to apply within the Army. And not everybody can make it. You've got to meet those height and weight requirements, have a very good record, and be recommended for it. And don't look at my waistline. I don't meet those height and weight requirements. Well, I meet the height requirements, but not the weight requirements anymore. I'm retired, so I get a little break there. Once you go to the regiment, you're assigned for a minimum of 3 years. It's a mandatory tour. And then you can try out for each of the specialty platoons, and one of those being the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Being in the society provides me the unique opportunity of engaging with tomb guards that have served across multiple generations. In fact, one of our oldest members walked down there in 1937. One of my best friends served down there in 1958. He was a relief commander for First Relief. I was a relief commander. He was a staff sergeant. I was a staff sergeant. We were both born on May 11th. Him a lot earlier than me. But when I sit and I talk to Jim Cardaman about his experience as a relief commander in 1958, they were the same as my experience as a relief commander in 1998. It's truly a unique organization where I have that instant bond with a fellow sentinel that may have served at a time different than I, and we have common ground. So like all the brand new sentinels that are down there, the young guys today, and men and women today, have that instant bond. We talk about the relief, we talk about the changing of the guard, we talk about the ceremonies, and we discover that it's the same. Little modifications such as weapons, like an M1 as compared to an M14. And so when I was doing a little more research to set up this slideshow, I came across a great old video, or a movie, I guess back in 1960. Now, anyone that has been in the military and has gone through reception have seen those propaganda done by their services that tell you about what not to do, what to do, those kinds of things. They got the great music playing in the background and the being narrated by somebody. This is the same thing. It's called the big picture. And this is a very small clip of what it looked like to change the guard in 1960. And if you've ever been to the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier and seen a current changing, you're going to see that there's not much of a change here. So with that, I want you to watch the big picture.
The mission of perpetually guarding this sacred shrine, 24 hours a day, every day of the year. This, too, is an honor for which the 1st Battle Group 3rd Infantry has been chosen. Today, beside the grave of an unknown soldier of World War I, lie an unknown serviceman of World War II. And another who fell in the Korean War. In the guard room beneath the amphitheater at Arlington Cemetery, men of the Honor Guard Company of the 3rd wait their turn. They carry out duties essential to the tradition of perfection surrounding every aspect of the Tomb Guard's mission. When the time comes to change the guard, the new man is ready in every detail for the assignment. Young men of the old guard are conscious of the tradition of their unit and the traditional ceremony that holds such deep meaning to all Americans.
Left shoulder, pull! Forward, pull!
For this assignment, each man must be a volunteer. Besides meeting certain physical requirements, the record of each man who guards the tomb must be of the highest caliber.
Forward, pull! Guard, pull! Ready, turn! Reserve, pull! Forward, pull! Ready, turn!
None of your orders.
Orders remain as directed.
Orders acknowledged.
Ready, turn! Reserve, pull!
Perpetual Guard, a highly esteemed responsibility of the 1st Battle Group, 3rd Infantry. The new guard begins a tour of duty that keeps alive the meaning of this symbol of sacrifice.
The guard change really hasn't been modified too much. And quite honestly, standing here with this giant screen behind me, I actually feel like I was back on the plaza for a second there. We as Sentinels hope that the public is able to look through us, because we're just the backstop, and see the tomb and see the unknown soldiers and understand why we guard them. To preserve that memory, to honor their sacrifice. We're doing a simple guard change that is dictated by the Army. Little modifications to make it a little sharper, because tomb guards have a way of trying to perfect everything that we do. In 1921, there was no guards again. 25, you had the civilian guards. In 1926, the first military guards. On April 2nd, 1937, we started the 24-hour guards. And since that time, the unknown soldiers have never been left alone. When you wake up in the middle of the night and you go to the kitchen to get a glass of water and you're looking out your kitchen window, you know that at that very moment there is a young man or woman that is standing to watch at the tomb of the unknown soldier. Doesn't matter the rain, the snow, the hurricanes, throw the bad weather at us, we love it. It's the best time up there. I personally love being up there at nighttime when there's no crowds and it's just you and the unknown soldiers, and you get to ponder who they are, where they came from, how they died, and how their families are doing now that they can't go to a specific grave. The training at the tomb consists of three different areas that we work on. One is obviously our performance, the mission, the reason that we're there. They perfect the guard change. They do re-ceremonies. We do briefings, obviously, to the public. We assist the public when they do their re-ceremonies, as well as when our nation's leaders and foreign heads of state come and lay wreaths at the tomb of the unknown soldier. The platoon is broken down into three different reliefs, and you can tell by their height. So the third relief is our short relief. They're about 5'11 to 6 foot. Second relief is 6 foot to 6 foot two. And then my relief, first relief, is 6'2 and above. So that when they're out there walking on the mat, you have uniformity across the board and everyone should look about the same. We notice it as tomb guards when there's a change in the two shifts that are coming up because we can see the height difference. We can also tell by the color of the stock sometimes that they're carrying. Members of the regiment, regardless of their sex or their MOS, are eligible to try out for the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. So you have to volunteer for the regiment, you have to volunteer to go down there, and about 90% attrition rate is what happens, just because of the training process. So learning the duty is difficult. Part of that is the uniform standards. We take the standards as derived by the United States Army under AR-670-1, and we just take them a little bit further and make them sharper. And we don't do this to draw attention to ourselves. Whenever you see a sentinel on the mat, the black mat that's in the back of the tomb, and they're walking back and forth, you'll notice there's no rank on their uniform. That's because we don't know the rank of the unknown soldiers. So we'll never outrank them. Even if I'm an E6 and I'm out there and I'm walking on the mat, I will do it with a blouse that has no rank on it. The process to get our uniforms up to what we consider a standard are pretty difficult. Now, anyone that's been in the military was probably issued good old-fashioned leather loafers. These are the same things that we have, except we have built up the base on them to protect us from the heat and the cold of the marble. We've put little metal cheaters on the inside, so when we do those heel clicks, we're not smacking our ankle bones together, which is very painful, I can tell you. And then we shine them to make them look like patent leather. And it takes hours. When I first started doing this, it took me about 8 hours to get a shoe somewhat where I thought was kind of close. And my trainer looked at it, laughed, and threw it down the hallway because I wasn't anywhere near close. And over time, I learned the techniques and the tricks to make it look like glass. And I could get them down to about 2 hours a shoe. And they weigh about 5 pounds apiece. I still have my trainers with all the nicks and scars on them. And it's still fun to be able to stand up and walk around in them and feel like you're back there at the tomb. The uniforms are full wool winter blues uniforms because they tend to hold the creases a lot better. But in the summertime, if you've been to D.C., you know that it's a swamp. Not just politically, it's literally a swamp. And so the humidity in the summertime is horrible. And at about 3 o'clock, 3:10 every afternoon, what happens in Washington, D.C.? It rains because the humidity just gets so bad. But that heavy wool uniform really looks good when you press it. So that's what they use. The other portion of the testing process to become a tomb guard is learning a various amount of knowledge. I've got my briefing book down here. It's not my knowledge book, but you can imagine a book of this size with 12 different poems, 200 different graves listed on it, and I think it's about 200 and some odd different questions. And every week they give me a page, and it's double-sided, and you have to memorize that verbatim. And then the next week, they're going to give you another page if you're able to recite that verbatim again. And it just builds and builds and builds and builds. So part of the knowledge happened when people would come into the cemetery in the 50s and say, well, where's Audie Murphy buried? Well, his tomb guards were supposed to know that. So right, he's buried over here. Well, can you show me how to get there? Of course I can show you, or I can tell you how to get there. And then where's JFK? Where's Pappy Boyington? Where's Lee Marvin? All those names that as you walk through the cemetery, you can see the people that impacted our nation. And so that's where our list of about 200 came. So all of a sudden now we have to know not only where they are, but how to get there in the middle of the night and something about those individuals. When we take our test, they take our book from us. And they make us stand at attention in our uniform, and they do our uniform inspection. And they say, recite your knowledge, go. And from the very first word to the very last word, we have to recite it verbatim, page after page after page. It takes about an hour. And when we're done with that, as if that wasn't difficult enough, they hand us a piece of paper and with 100 questions on it and say, now write it out. And don't miss a pronunciation or don't miss a comma or don't miss a letter, because each one of those is points against you and you have to get 95% to pass the written test. It takes about 7 to 12 months, depending on the sentinel, to earn their Tomb Guard Identification Badge. Now, this badge is the third least awarded badge in the Army. It used to be the second least awarded until the horsemanship badge was created. And the badge itself takes a lot of what you see on the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier into its design. You have the inverted wreaths. You have the three figures on the front of it, peace, victory, and valor. You have the words honor guard written across the bottom, because we are a guard of honor for these unknown soldiers. Just out of curiosity, does anybody know what the least awarded Army badge might be? Who said it? Astronaut badge. Fantastic. There's just not a lot of ground pounders running around in state or in space. We anticipate giving or awarding the Tomb Guard Identification Badge to about 5 to 6 sentinels a year, because it takes so long to go through the process and for them to meet the standard that we expect to see out of them. This is also the only badge that can be revoked after you leave the military. So I decide for one day to do something crazy, like, I don't know, sell a bunch of drugs or whatever, and I get busted by the cops. This badge can be revoked, removed from my military record, even though I've been retired from the military for many years. Down in the quarters, we have a large badge board that lists every sentinel since 1958 that has received the Tomb Guard Identification Badge. And on it, there will be some that just simply say, revoked. And each one of them are numbered. So if you ever go to the tomb and you see the badge board, you'll see number 457. That's mine. That's not saying that since then there's only been, I think we're up to 658 or 59 badges issued, because that happened in 1958. But tomb guards have been around, people guarding the tomb since 24 hours a day since 1937. There just wasn't a badge created at that time. This is one of the things on a tomb guard's uniform you will not touch. And the other one being their shoes. Not unless you want to get in a fist fight. The Sentinel's Creed is something that we live by. Even now that I've left the military, one of the lines in our Sentinel's Creed talks about, my standard will remain perfection. I take that to heart in everything that I do. Everything that I learned when I was down at the tomb, I transition over. It drives my wife crazy sometimes, but that's just the way it was beat into me. And I will continually carry that Sentinel's Creed over and over and over again. In 2021, there's going to be a centennial celebration for the 100th anniversary of the original burial of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. We're working with the federal government and other agencies such as World War I, National Museum and Memorial, to try and bring some of the stories about the unknown soldiers to light. Because we all know when they left France and they arrived in Washington, D.C., but what happened in the middle? And how can we as a nation suddenly come together as a community of communities and pause and remember on November 11th in the national salute? If you ever feel like you would like to help us out, just simply go to our websites and look for the centennial information, and we'd be glad to have you supporting us and right there next to us, because we are part of you. This is your national shrine. This is the place where you can go and pause and reflect upon the sacrifices of so many Americans over so many different conflicts. With that, I think we have a time to open it up for questions.
And ladies and gentlemen, we would ask that you join us at either of the microphones. If you're not able to come down to a microphone, flag me and I can come up to you.
Oh, I know everybody has seen the email that's gone around that says that we don't drink and we don't curse and we remain celibate for the rest of our lives. I know you want to ask that question. I know you do.
See, you started with high expectations is how you were just ending. And so then, right, high expectations for a really good question.
Yeah.
How long is your shift?
How long
so
is
the question,
shift?
Yeah, thank you.
Perfect. No, I'm sorry that I didn't cover that. It's a great question. So when the cemetery is open in the summertime, the shifts for a sentinel during the daylight hours is half an hour. And in that half an hour, they will walk the mat and at 21 times or 21 paces along the mat. They'll pause and face the tomb for 21 seconds. There's a lot of 21s built into that. And does anybody know why 21 is such an important number for us? 21-gun salute. It's our nation's highest way of saying we recognize you, we honor you. In that time, during those half hours, there might be a couple re-ceremonies, so the sentinel may not be on the mat the entire half hour. In the wintertime and at nighttime, that half hour is extended to one full hour. And again, there might be some re-ceremonies in there. And someone had asked a question earlier today about the guard change that you see going on, does that happen at midnight? One in the morning? Yes, it does. Regardless if there's anyone standing on those steps, the exact same guard change happens. So good question about the hours. Thank you.
I think there was another question right here.
You told us that the flags are presented to the president. What becomes of the flags after the president accepts the flag for the unknown? And the other question that's always been something that I want to know the answer to, what became of the Medal of Honor for our Vietnam unknown?
Good questions, both of them. So the actual flags that were placed upon the caskets and folded by the Joint Forces Colors team and presented to the next of kin are on display in the memorial display room, which is directly to the west of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. If you didn't know it was there, it's behind the giant doors. It's in the memorial room. Go in there and look, because you will be amazed. You'll see the war bonnet from Chief Plenty Coup and his coup stick. You'll see each of those flags that were put on the caskets. You're also going to find each of the Medals of Honor. So specifically regarding the Vietnam Unknown Soldier, the Medal of Honor was awarded in the name of Congress to the Vietnam Unknown Soldier. When that soldier was identified, that medal stayed there in Arlington. It wasn't conferred upon Captain Blase. So I hope that answers your question. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, that is our only duty when you're assigned to the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. It doesn't seem like we work much when you look at a calendar, because a relief will come on duty and they serve at the tomb for 24 hours. Actually about 26, 28 when you add getting there early and leaving late. But that 24-hour period, they live down in the quarters, they perform their duties. And then that relief will get a day off. And then they'll come back and they'll do another set of 24 hours. Then they'll get another day off, and then do their final 24 hours in that work week. So on calendar, they only work 9 days. But those are 9 solid days, 24, 26, 28 hours a day. So when we're not down there, we're off taking care of uniforms. If they're in training, learning their knowledge, trying to impress upon the badge holders that they want to be there and they know what they're doing and improve their skills. And even as a badge holder, as a tomb guard badge holder, I would still come down and I would practice and I would rehearse and I would make sure that what I'm doing is perfection as best as I can get it.
Ma'am, can you hold on just a second?
That test you went through, I thought maybe you used that knowledge for lectures or did something else with that knowledge.
The current tomb guards do a briefing every day, and I want to say it's at 10 o'clock and they may do one at 1400, just depending on their mission load. And they'll do a briefing, something similar to this, obviously a lot more condensed, probably about in 15 minutes, just giving a brief history. When I was down there, we didn't stand outside to answer questions from the public. In the 50s and 60s, that did happen, which is why we have that knowledge put upon us. And it's not just the unknown soldiers. It's also about Arlington It's about the Army, it's about our regiment, and everything that surrounds the unknown soldiers. So I hope that answers your question.
I believe our next question is going to be coming from Claudine, who is wanting to be sure that I get my workout in for the day. She is also a phenomenal volunteer at the National World War I Museum and Memorial.
Could you tell me, do you know at this point what is going to happen in the years to come? Because we can't seem to keep away from war. And there will be others. What are the plans? There's only three spots there now. Is there enough room for the future?
Very good question. With the advances in DNA technology, I seriously doubt that there will ever be another unknown soldier. For those of you that served any time recently, it seems like every year when we do our medical screening, we provide another DNA sample for the databases. So I don't think that you're going to see another unknown soldier from any of the conflicts ever identified or placed in Arlington National Cemetery. I hope that answers your question.
Now I know.
If not, Laura can run back up the stairs again.
Right. Ladies and gentlemen, I know that there probably are some more questions, and we would welcome those. But I believe now is also the time for me to say it is truly an honor to have on the stage someone who's able to share about the history of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. And we're so pleased to be partnering with you all as we head towards that centennial and all that it means as well. And we would encourage you to take a look at the website for the Society of the Honor Guard Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. We would encourage you to also join our partners, Heartland Men's Chorus, and find out more about the amazing story that is being told in music and in art later in June. Join us next week as we explore more of this story, and join us any day you want to over the summer. We're open 7 days a week, and it's a joy to have you here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Gavin McIlvenna.